And we've got some amazing statements around here. We've got the Holy Ghost fire. We've got no weapon formed against me can prosper. This one here, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Great statements. How many people believe that they are great statements? You know, what amazes me is we've got this book that is full of amazing promises, amazing statements, statements of power, statements of victories. You know, Jesus never ever says you're going to have to go through hell. He went through hell for us. Amen? He doesn't say you're going to have to struggle and strive on this planet. He says you can do all things and I'm going to give you life and you're going to give it to you more abundantly. He wants us to overcome. He wants us to triumph. So we've got all this precious promises, and the Bible says you shall know the truth and the truth will make you free, which is an amazing statement too. But I want to just say this, the truth and confessing the truth makes you free. It's what you actually say will either cause you to live in victory or in defeat. There's no doubt about it, these words are true, and yet so many times we live so far below God's expectation of us. How many people believe that Jesus wants a church that's going to be victorious? He wants a church that's going to what? Rule and reign with him on this planet. He wants a church to be prosperous and in good health. Look, we could stand all day here just saying what God wants and what we don't really have. We're not seeing the manifestation because we do something out of our mouth that nullifies the Word of God. We've got to come into agreement with the Word of God. We've got to stand strong on the Word of God. Amen? We've got to believe the Word of God. And out of our heart will flow, will come out of our mouth what we really believe. And I believe that it's time that we really, really took, I guess, notice of what really comes out of our mouth, because that's who you are and that's where you're at right now. And I believe that God wants us to change a few things. Amen? We give mental acceptance to scriptures like I can, all these sort of things. I am a child of God, we're singing today. Doesn't that make you feel good? And then we go away defeated. If we're, you know, really God's children, he wants us to be successful. He wants us to be victorious. The ladies go living successfully. They go through all the wonderful stuff. And why should we go home then and be a failure? Why should we not expect everything that God says to come to pass? So I believe that all these things, greater is he that's within me. Then the enemy or a situation or a circumstance comes against us and causes us to speak wrong, to think wrong. Thoughts are sown into our minds, which eats up our victory. You know, we can say one moment, by the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. And the next moment, we can say, I'm sick. There's nothing I can do. I've tried everything and all this. Can you understand where I'm coming from today? So we've got to change the way we speak. We've got to change the way we think. We've got to change in a lot of areas. And it's got a lot to do with our mouth. These things come and eat up our victory. How you think will cause the Word of God. How many believe that the Word of God will produce life? But the Word of how you think and how you speak will cause the Word of God to produce either life or death. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. If you use the right fertilizer and water your garden, the plants will grow. Is that okay? How many people know that that's a fact? I know that a lot of people murder plants because they don't water them. They don't fertilize them. I'm looking at some plants that I've got at the moment and I've realized that the reason that the soil hasn't got the substance in it that it needs to grow. But I want to tell you, friends, if you fertilize your plants and if you water your plants, they will grow. It's a known fact. And if you fertilize the Word of God with faith-filled words, I want to tell you, you'll grow. You'll produce. You'll develop. You'll become what God wants us to become. I believe that all of creation is groaning for the manifestation of the children of God. to become what God really wants us to be, to become the people that Jesus really wants us to be, the church triumphant, the church victorious, ruling and reigning with him. No weapon formed against us can prosper. Everything that rises against us in judgment, we condemn it, we pull it down, we break the strongholds. But sometimes there, when you bring a wheelchair out and the lady's already had one leg foot amputated, half the leg, and the other one is not in a very good condition. So when you start to lay hands on that, your mind, how many people know your mind? But friend, somehow or other, we've got to create something greater in our mind, and you've got to start to think about creative miracles. You've got to let your mind loose, and you've got to somehow or other let your faith loose and start to believe. You see, if we don't start speaking about creative miracles, guess what? They will never happen. If we don't start speaking about the victory, it will never happen. If we don't start speaking right and start to say what God says, how many people know that Jesus did creative miracles? Amen? Did he do creative? Did he or didn't he? And he said, these things that I do, you shall do also. If you read the Azusa Street Revival, there were creative miracles. Arms grew out. Limbs were just totally restored. Eyes, things there that were missing, parts of human bodies that were taken out were replaced. Because God is the creator, amen. And I believe that we're going to see creative miracles. We're going to see amazing things happen. So if you put the right fertilizer, it will certainly grow. Satan comes to attack the mind of man. In John 10:10, the word of God says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. But it says that there's an enemy that comes to rob, to kill, and to destroy. Friend, many times we think that God just wants to rob and kill to destroy me. You know what he wants to rob and kill and destroy? The word of God. What the word of God says. And today we're seeing that there's so many people that are peddling scriptures and different things like that have got no power in them, got no victory in them. They're full of excuses. But friend, I want to tell you that we've got to stand up and we've got to say, hey, our God heals. Our God delivers, hallelujah. Our God saves. Our God can do it. And because of that, now I can do that. I've got to learn that I can do these things. Satan's greatest weapon against you is the power of suggestion. Really, if Jesus stripped the enemy of all of his power, and if God gave us power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the works of Satan, and nothing shall by any means hurt us, and if God gave me the power that whatever is formed against me will not prosper, I am condemn those things, why then does the enemy triumph over the church? Because the word of God has been taken away. The power out of the word, it's been watered down, it's been diluted, it's been polluted. There are some ministries today, and friend, we've got to be careful what we're listening to. They might have, thousands and thousands of people in their congregation, but if they tell you today that there's no need for repentance, don't ever switch them on again. They tell you that grace is now sufficient. You can do whatever you like. You don't have to repent. It's okay. God knows all about it. Friend, I want to tell you, be warned. The word of God has been messed about with. It's been diluted. And the enemy wants to come to rob and to kill and to destroy the word of God. But friend, I want to tell you, we have got nothing else to stand upon but the word of God. Hallelujah. We've got nothing else that we can build our faith upon. It's no little whim or no little thing like that. We've got to build our faith and our life upon the word of God. And the word of God says, yea, amen. We've got to somehow or other break every stronghold. But the enemy will come against you and tell you you'll never make it or it'll never change or this or that. Friend, that's where we've got to say, devil, get out of my life. Get out of my face, amen. Because my God... See, who are you going to believe today, the devil or God? Who are you going to believe? See, this is the thing. It's all about faith. Satan's greatest weapon is the power of suggestion. You know, a spiritual law too few of us really realize is this, that our confessions rule us. Your confession rules you. Do you know that? That's a spiritual law. I've seen men and women of great faith, men and women of who've known God, fall into the trap of allowing circumstances. How many people know that we have circumstances? Situations come our way. What are you going to say to these things? The Bible says, what are you going to say to persecution and all these things? God's got an answer for you. He says, you say this, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Or you bow to the circumstance and you allow the circumstance to dictate and dominate and control your life. Friend, I would tell you what, I'd rather be controlled by the word of God than any circumstance. Amen. Yeah. That settles it. That's finished. Amen. And see, I believe what's happened is the church has been lulled asleep in Delilah's lap. We've been lulled asleep by sort of the anointing, the power, the victory taken out of the word. And we've got to come back, I believe. We've got to come back to the word of God. I've seen men and women that allowed circumstances and situations that come into their life speak louder than the word of God. That's what happens. Romans 10, 9 and 10. This is what the Bible says, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. My wife keeps reminding me, saved, salvation, it really means total preservation from surrounding evil. See, God, when he saved you, didn't just throw you a rubber ducky so you could float around in a pool of sharks, trying to pull your feet up or something like that. No, he delivered us out of. The Bible says he took me out of a kingdom and took me into another kingdom. Hallelujah. He took me out of failure and defeat and brought me into victory. He took me out of that negativity into positivity. He's taken me out of something to bring me into something. But friends, so many times we want to run back here because circumstances, and we confess the situation that we're in instead of confessing what the word of God says about the situation. It's not easy, because I want to tell you this, circumstances will scream at you. And the devil's greatest victory, greatest power, is the power of suggestion. Salvation from surrounding evil. For the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew or Greek, bond or free, educated or not, rich or poor. There's no distinction, amen. When I got saved, I was just a bloke that needed to get saved. I had no idea what God's plan for my life was. I just went to church. I heard a story about a man who loved me so much that he died for me. I was a lonely, broken, distraught, going through life, struggling like most people. But I found that there was a man who loved me so much that he gave his life for me. And somehow or other, I was touched in my heart. And the man at the front made an altar call, and I started a journey. That first step was a journey. If I hadn't have taken that step, I don't know where I would be today. But I took that one step, and I began to walk out the front, and I gave my life to Jesus Christ. I began to read the Bible, and I began to read the Gospels, and found out more about this man who died for me, who gave his life for me. Something started to stir within me. We started to want God more than anything else. I started to change. Things started to happen. And then as we got on the road a little bit, the Spirit of God started to deal with me. Sometimes I was on 4 altar calls on one night. There's a problem. There's somebody here with that problem. Yeah, that's me. I'd just be getting up off the floor and walking back to my chair, and that's me. Get up again and whoa, that's me. I had every problem, amen? I needed to be saved. Delivered from all destruction, all the enemy had poured out. But then God started to work on my life. And you see, I was a bundle of problems. I left school when I was 13. I was trying to be successful, but found it very, very difficult. And you know, you worked hard, and I still work hard. Wanting to be successful. And then we get sort of in this church, and all of a sudden God wants me. Wants to put his finger on me. I can't do that. I could never do that. I wouldn't be able to do that. We're running a children's church. Children's church grew from pretty well zero to 600 people in a short period of time. Kids were getting saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. Amazing things were happening. I don't know how many, there would have been thousands of young people would have been touched in that period of time. That was only in about an 18-month, two-year period. Then you go to be a pastor. I thought, oh God, I could never be a pastor. Because you see, I'm not educated. And to be a pastor, you have to be educated. You've got to be able to use all those words. All those big words. And you've got to be able to say all those. It's why they call those people those names, I don't know. And why don't they just call them Fred and Jack and Jill and Bill? Philemon. Man, what a stupid name that'd be. Sorry, Philemon, I didn't mean to offend you. But all those towns and all those things, and so you struggle and you think you can't do it, and all of a sudden you start to realize that it's really got nothing to do. Look, I'm not against education. I believe in education. But friend, there's something that's more important than education. It's called the anointing. Amen. It's called the anointing, amen. It's called ministering out of the anointing. And all of a sudden you start to break through and you start to break down barriers. We've been singing about strongholds have got to be broken. I want to tell you, that's me. Is that you? Amen. Come on, is that you? Is there more strongholds to be broken? Is there more barriers? Is there more walls to knock down? Come on, let's knock a few walls down, hallelujah. I like knocking walls down, don't I, Greg? I love knocking things down, glory to God. I'm going to knock a tree down. Anyone who wants to come and help me? The neighbor's fence is looking very, very dangerous at the moment. You see, Nancy, she was born out of wedlock. Crazy things. Who am I? Rejection, bitterness, all that sort of stuff filled their life. But all of a sudden, one day, through the anointing, everybody say anointing. Through the anointing, a prophetic man came and put his hand on her head and said, God knows your name, and hallelujah, set her free. And today she sets hundreds of people free. You see, there's walls that you've got to break down if you want to go to the place where God can meet with you. And if we keep confessing that I'm not educated and all that sort of stuff, friend, I don't give two about that anymore. Because I want to tell you, the anointing is more important to me. I've got Chris can help me with all the other stuff. Hallelujah, amen. You don't mind, do you? But you know what I've heard? After I've given my testimony, Nancy's given her testimony, people look at and they say, if Neil and Nance can do it, I can do it. See, I would rather be a fool for Jesus. I'm not ashamed of it. I'd rather be a fool if it can make you take one more step towards your destiny. One more step to see that wall coming down. One more step to see you break through into what God has for you. Because I want to tell you, friends, we are not here playing tiddlywinks. We're not here playing church. We're here to win the Sunshine Coast for Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We're here to be part of the answer. It's not just us. There are many, many people on the Sunshine Coast. We're just a few, hallelujah. But we're going to rise up. We're going to break through every wall. We're going to break through every barrier that we can ever break through. We're going to become what God wants us to become. Because that's what I believe Jesus wants. so many people get broken. Proverbs 6:2 says, you are snared by the words of your mouth. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. Mark 11:23 says this, for assuredly, I don't know about your Bible, but you can't most really see it up there, but in your Bible it's written in red. That means Jesus speaking the words, amen? This is Jesus saying, as if he was standing right in front of you, Roma, and he's saying, assuredly, Roma, I'm speaking to you. Greg, assuredly, I'm speaking to you. I'm speaking to you right now. I'm not messing with you. I'm not playing with you. I'm talking to you. I've got to take the word like that, amen? He's talking to me, hallelujah. Assuredly, I say to you. Neil, assuredly, I say to you. What's your name? Put your name in there. Assuredly, I say to you. If I can find where it was. Where was I? For assuredly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, whether you're a Jew or a Greek, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things that he says will be done. When it's talking about mountains, really what it's talking about is obstacles. It's talking about things that stand in front of you. Assuredly, I say to you, assuredly, I say to you, whoever says to this obstacle, this problem, this situation that stands in front of you, whether you're Jew or Greek, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believe that those things that he says will be done, he will have whatever he says, good or bad. I want you to note, number one, that it's written in red, it's Jesus' words. Jesus speaking. I've got a question that I want to ask you. Did Jesus know what he was talking about? Come on, this might help your thought a little bit. When Jesus spoke all these things about you can do what these things that I do, you can do also, did he know what he was talking about? Was he playing with us? Did he really know when he says, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I am more than a conqueror. Did he know what he was talking about when he said these things? Or were they words of an irresponsible dreamer? Were they words of an irresponsible dreamer? Trying to take us up the tree that I'm going to cut down in a couple of days' time and then chop it out. Amen? Or was he telling us the truth? Did he know what he was talking about? When he says, no weapon formed against you can prosper. And every tongue that rises against you in judgment, you condemn it. Friend, I want a bit of fire inside of your belly. I want a fire to burn on the inside of us that will cause us to rise up. And every time a devil comes against us or circumstances come against you, I want to tell you, that's going to be the sorriest day of the devil's life. Hallelujah. The devil, he'll walk past these little herd of devils, and when he comes to your house, you say, shh, shh, shh. Don't mess with him. Don't mess with her. They whipped me last week. Eh? Eh? You gotta see this. You gotta see the little devil. Don't you? The picture you have in your mind, that's the picture of the devil, amen. The Bible says, now Chris will help me here, that in the end time, he's displayed, isn't he? Yep. And what does he, how does he come?
The picture is of a triumphal procession where he's as the chief captain.
Yeah, and he's about that big. He's about that big. And you know, we're going to look and say, that's not the one that attacked me. No, the one that's over here is that big one, eh? Here is a big one. No, he's a little one. He's under your foot. You can crush him like a bug.
Amen.
Eh? Oh, shakabundi, amen. He knew exactly what he was saying, and he said exactly what he wanted to say. You shall have whatever you say. Friend, I want to tell you, we've got to change our mind. A key that I've found to break the strongholds in my life. I'd like for you, if you've got your Bibles, because I want you to have a look at this with me. It's found in the book of Joshua. I know that you're going to just bear witness with me here. After the death of Moses, Joshua 1 verse 1, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun. Man, I thought I was bad. He was the son of Nun. Poor guy. There's another fellow in there by the name of Dodo. Dear Jesus. I'm going to say it again. The Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, and here's a word that's been coming through, arise. Everybody say arise. Arise. What does that mean? Get up off your blessed assurance. Here is a man. You think, oh, but Joshua. He was 85. Was he 85? Somewhere around 85. Moses, who he had all his hope on, had just died. He would have been feeling despised, disappointed, all the words that we could put into it. He's miserable. How are we ever going to do it now? The Moses is gone, blah, blah, blah. And then God starts to speak to him. He says, arise. Arise out of that. Friend, this man had to overcome and had to break through some strongholds and had to break through some walls, had to break through negativity, had to break through all those sort of things to be able to grasp what God had for him. Arise, glory to God. Church, arise. Go over this Jordan. The Jordan was the obstacle that he had to go over. The Jordan was in flood. It was impossible to penetrate. It was impossible to do it. But I want to tell you, friends, there's nothing too hard for God. There is nothing too difficult for our God. It is not too difficult for God to give that woman new limbs. It is not too difficult for God to do mighty miracles in your life. It's not too difficult for God to take somebody that thought he was a loser and make him into something important. All I had was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful out of my life. Hallelujah. I'm so glad I took that first step. I'm so glad I took that step. And I pray that some of us, and I'm continuing to take steps, amen. Doesn't mean now because I took that step I can sit back. I want to tell you, every day I forge ahead. Every day I take another step. Every day, the enemy says, I'll give up, you silly old goat. Glory to God. Who do you think you are? No, all I know is God says, unfinished business. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We've had prophetic words through here that God's going to do great things. We just take another step, amen. We take another step, closer and closer, step up, one step at a time, amen. We're going to do it. You believe that? We're going to see it. We're going to see King Jesus reigning on the Sunshine Coast. We're going to see it. Glory to God. We're going to see it. Hallelujah. I'm saying glory to God a lot today, aren't I? Go over this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses. From the wilderness of this Lebanon, as far as the great river of the Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites and to the great sea towards the going down of the sun shall be your territory. Then listen to this. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Friend, I want to tell you, you've got to grab hold of these verses of Scripture and you've got to be able to speak these words out. I don't care what man can do unto me, but no man shall be able to stand before me all the days of my life. Hallelujah. Do you believe that? As I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage, for to this people, you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate. Everybody say meditate. Meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous. And then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid nor dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with you wherever you go. Hallelujah. Man, we got to read these scriptures. We got to read the word. Get excited about what God is doing in our land. To meditate, to wait upon. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall what? They shall rise up as on wings of eagles. They shall run and not get weary. They shall walk and not faint. The young men shall fall at their right hand and then blush. Glory. Praise God. Amen. To tarry, to wait. To wait with expectancy. Knowing if God before me, who can be against me? Who can separate me from the love of God? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Hebrews 4:14 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. That same word means confession. Let us hold fast our confession. Knowing that Jesus loves you and cares for you. He gave this example. If you remember last week, we talked about after the resurrection. Peter, with the boys, they were disappointed. They were going through hell. Peter said, I'm going fishing. Rest said, we're going with you. But Jesus never left or forsook them. Because of their stupidity, he went after them. I praise God today that God's never ever left me nor forsaken me. I've been stupid, but I tell you what, he's always gone after me. I've made wrong decisions. I've done some stupid things. But God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He'll never ever leave us nor forsake us. Jesus, who was about to take his rightful place at the right hand of the Father. Can you imagine this? After completing the work he was sent to do, Bible says, for this purpose was the Son of God made manifest, that he might destroy the works of Satan. He made a show of him, amen. After all the horrible sufferings he went through, and now he's ready to return to the place at the right hand of God. He steps aside for just a while. He steps aside for people just like you and me. Cooks breakfast for those confused, cold, hungry disciples who didn't deserve it. And he wanted to issue them the last instructions, feed my sheep. He's our high priest today, he's in the heavens. He's making intercession for us. He's worthy of our praise. Can you imagine Princess Elizabeth at her coronation? About to be crowned queen of the British Empire. Stepping aside to go to a river to cook breakfast for a few fishermen. Jesus' coronation would have been more grandeur than anything that could have ever happened on this planet. than any earthly parade. Can you imagine what it would have been like? Jesus ready. All the patriarchs and all the martyrs and thousands and upon thousands of people that had died without the hope, without seeing the hope, but died in faith, believing that there was going to be a Savior. There was going to be a Messiah. All those people, can you imagine the crescendo, the roar, as the resurrected champion begins to take his place, begins to enter in to glory. The Bible says round about the throne, there was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands upon thousands. And I was sitting in my office and just meditating and just trying to capture the grandeur, the anointing, the atmosphere, and if I can use a little bit of license and my imagination sometimes, but I saw in one corner hundreds and hundreds of people. They didn't have an instrument, they were the instrument. And the sound of trumpets came out of them. Over the road, a little bit further, there's another great, great choir of people there. And as they opened up their mouth, the sounds of organs came out of them. There were sounds of praise and there were sounds of worship. There were sounds, my goodness gracious, that our minds cannot comprehend as he began to usher in, as they crowned him, with all that they could ever do, crowned him King of Kings and Lord of Lords, hallelujah. Friend, today he does wear the victor's crown. Today he wears that victor's crown, and because he lives, he's right beside the right hand of the Father, and he's seen a bunch of people here in a hired hall and on the Sunshine Coast, and he's watching us, and he's listening to our praise, and he can go a shuck upon me. I don't know about you, but that excites me. And as he looks over and he touches his dad on the shoulder, and he says, "Dad, look at them down there. Look at them. They want me. They want me. Hallelujah. They want the Holy Ghost power. They want to see a move of the Spirit. Oh, send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire." Woo. Oh, shakabundi. I'm getting goosebumps on the goosebumps. Send the fire. Send the fire, Dad. Send the fire. How many people want the fire? Come stand to our feet today. Musicians and singers, we're going to sing that crown song again. Whatever it is. The victor's crown. He wears the victor's crown. He has triumphed over hell and death. Oh, Shatabunde. He has triumphed over every sickness and every disease. He has triumphed over everything.